Hello and welcome to episode 17 of the Learning and Teaching at Newcastle University podcast. My name's Ben Steele and I'll be your host for this week. In this episode, Graeme Redshaw-Boxwell from LTDS speaks to Sarah Graham, Dean of Education in our Faculty of Humanities and Social Science, also known as HAS, Dr. Ruth Valentine, Dean of Taught Programmes for our Faculty of Medical Science, also known as FMS, and Dr. Sarah Marsham, our Dean of Education for Science, Agriculture and Engineering, also known as SAGE. Now, Graham, Sarah, Ruth and Sarah all have a conversation about assessment. As we're in the midst of our assessment period, we thought we'd get the Dean's view. So, over to Graham.
Okay, so let's talk about in relation to assessment and feedback. What do we do well at Newcastle?
I think one of the things we do really well within the Faculty of Medical Sciences on giving feedback is something that we developed a few years ago in medicine. Giving automatic feedback using a personalised website. So this is something that we deliver through our virtual learning environment. But each of our students, when they do an online assessment, whether they do a written assessment or whether they do a summative examination, when they get their marks back, they get their marks back and they're colour-coded. So they get green if they're doing really well and they're top of their cohort. Amber if they're passing, but they're kind of near that borderline pass, or red, you know, just highlighting to the students that they're below that pass mark and they need to up their game. But they also get personalised feedback alongside that. And this all happens on the virtual learning environment. And as I say, we brought it in a few years ago and the students really appreciate being able to see that. They can also see where their mark sits in comparison to the cohort. So even though they're passing and they think they're doing well, they can see that they're, you know, maybe not top of the class, but they're not bottom of the class, they're somewhere in the middle. And we also break it down to give them feedback, say if it's on exam questions, feedback on whether they're doing well on a particular area in the exam. So again, for medicine, you know, your physiology questions you did really well on, but your biochemistry questions maybe you didn't do quite so well on. So they can see where they're doing well and where they're not doing well. And that's worked really well in medicine, and we're kind of bringing that out and using it in dentistry as well. So that's one thing I think we're doing well. And I think from feedback from the students, they really appreciate that.
Sarah or Sarah?
From Humanities and Social Sciences. So I've just had the privilege of reviewing all of our external examiner reports. And of course, their focus is very much on assessment and feedback in the programmes, not just for assuring standards and for quality purposes, but also there's a lot of detail in those reports about the assessments themselves and how our programme teams respond to assessment. So they, rather than me, kind of brought out a number of practices in HAS that seem to be working really well. There was a lot of discussion and description, and the students also feedback on this as well, around the innovation in assessment, particularly in the last couple of years. So despite, you know, an accredited program where you've got very mandated formats, the teams were still able to innovate and really switch out that assessment design. So design is something I think that our external examiners in HAS think that we do well. In terms of the focus or the context of the assessment, there's a lot of good practice and good commentary, not just in our external examiner reports, but in our AMRs and in my observations too, that there's a global outlook to a lot of the assessments that are designed. So they're either hinging on that real world authentic, or they're heading in that direction, which is really interesting. And external examiners comment on how prepared that enables our students to be for graduateness and for work. There's a lot of great stuff around our feedback too, particularly with the introduction of Canvas. I think it's been a real success in terms of trying and supporting the innovation of practice and iterative design. So I can see feedback rubrics being used really successfully, and feedback, like Ruth says, you know, against particular marking bands, which is super helpful to be able to a student to position themselves, because it's all about them understanding where they are and what they can do with that feedback, and then working on it for their next assessment for learning. So yeah, some great examples of good assessment practice and innovation in HAS, and also some great examples of using Canvas and digital platforms to enable effective feedback. Still lots of work to do as well, though, and I might come back to talking a little bit about some of the work that we've done with at the company Naus in relation to our feedback later in the podcast.
And Sarah?
So yeah, just picking up on Faculty of Science, Agriculture and Engineering, I think like Sarah, we have a whole range of assessment, which is really welcoming to see that, you know, across, we've just been doing some work around authentic assessment, which is something we might pick up on again in a little while. But actually it was really reassuring to see that a lot of colleagues were already implementing this within their modules. And in relation to that, they'd received a lot of really good feedback from students in relation to that assessment and different practices. I think just to take that a step further, one of the things that we see a lot of comments on from our external examiners is our very thorough and transparent moderation procedures. You know, this might not always be something students fully understand, but there is a lot of good practice in the faculty where colleagues are trying to engage students in explaining how moderation and scaling processes work, you know, sharing the policies with them, and sort of engaging students in the use of our marking criteria and our rubrics, especially when we have those assessments that are quite novel and quite innovative. Often students maybe are a bit concerned about how they're going to be marked and how they're going to be assessed on them, because it isn't a traditional essay or a traditional exam. And I think our colleagues have taken a lot of time to create very assessment specific criteria that allows multiple markers to ensure that they're being fair and consistent, but it also allows students to see where they're achieving marks, but also where they need to be improving on for the next time. And it's about, you know, having that dialogue with them about using that feedback to go forward. But then our external examiner is recognizing the processes that we go through as a team, you know, going through moderation, module moderation boards, and taking that through into our boards of examiners.
Great, thanks. I mean, I think, you know, with my role, I'm really delighted to hear the good news about Canvas. And I think that's been a real success. I think the other thing for listeners of the podcast, there is a case studies database that there is lots and lots of good examples and a lot that's been added since the pandemic started about, you know, good practices around assessment and feedback and many other issues as well. So please have a look at that. Okay, so our assessment practices changed dramatically during the pandemic. What lessons can we learn from this? What has worked? What should we keep doing? And what should we change?
I can pick up on that. So I think just picking up on something Sarah said was around the accrediting bodies. And I think previously we've always been a little uncertain about, you know, maybe doing quite different pieces of assessment because we've always thought that the accrediting bodies, you know, wouldn't necessarily like that. They wouldn't, you know, recognize what we were doing. I think one of the real successes of the pandemic is the support that we've received from our accrediting bodies to do different things. I think it's allowed a lot of colleagues to recognize that, you know, the restrictions in place that we often perceive aren't necessarily there. And I think as long as we have those clear lines of communication with our accrediting bodies, that actually they're really supportive of us changing and doing those assessments. I think from a SAGE perspective, sort of generally, it's got a lot of colleagues thinking more broadly about assessment. You know, we have a lot of good practice across the faculty, and, you know, a lot of colleagues are really keen to keep their assessment updated. But I think there have been, you know, this has allowed us to use it as a real springboard to actually think about more cohesive assessment, thinking about, you know, assessment not in a standalone way, but also multiple assessments within a module and how they fit together, but then also across a program, and actually getting people thinking about how assessments in one module relate to assessments in another module, and having that pathway of assessment progression clearer, not only for colleagues but also for students. And I think, you know, the technology as well, with, again, you know, complementing Canvas, that's really allowed us to do lots of different things and really enhance the diversity of assessment that's available to our students.
I think if I come in there as well, just to echo what Sarah's just said there, I think within FMS, we've had feedback from our external examiners on on actually how innovative some of our assessments have been over the last academic year, how we've been able to develop critical thinking in the way that we've carried out our assessments, which was there before, but maybe, you know, because we've had to think about the way we've assessed our students differently, actually the way our students have tackled the examinations, they've done it differently, and that's come out, and the external examiners have seen that. The other thing I did want to point out, really, I think that's worked really well over the pandemic with us changing to different forms of assessment, is how we've worked with the TEL team within FMS and the TEL team within LTDS. I think, you know, being able to have access to Canvas and all the things that Canvas will do to allow us to be more innovative, but also the support we've had to be able to do those developments and work with our programme teams. I think that's worked really well. You know, in FMS, we've got some real good examples where students actually sat online examinations for some of our accredited programmes where we had to carry out online examinations. And they went really well, where our students were fully supported throughout the actual assessment. They were, you know, they actually could speak to an academic if they needed to. We had Zoom rooms available for students to have chats if things went wrong whilst they were on their assessment. And the way that we were able to deliver questions, so questions were coming in different orders for different students, and even the actual answers were coming in different orders. So reducing that risk of students colluding. And I think that has worked really well. And I think we were very worried before we did the online assessments. We thought that maybe there was a big risk here, and the students, I think, were worried as well. But I think actually the way we handled it worked out really well. And I think some of our programmes will be continuing to use those online assessments. So it shows that it wasn't just a one-off, a thing that we did during the pandemic. Actually, it's something that we can take forward. So I think we've learned a lot. I think we've also learned a lot of what doesn't work well, which is also a good thing, that we know maybe there were some things that we did as knee-jerk reactions that later on, if we'd had that time to think a little bit more, we wouldn't have done in such a way. But you know, it's all a learning curve, and I think our students and staff appreciate that.
Yeah, I was actually just wondering about the sort of student feedback that you've received about that support. For example, I know that the FMS TEL team worked really hard on those Zoom support calls.
Yeah, I mean, we were lucky in one way that actually not many students needed that support. Actually, when it went down to the assessments, pretty much went smoothly. But the students that did need that support got it immediately and got to speak to someone. And I think, yeah, that it was invaluable. So the feedback we've had from students has been really, really positive.
Great. Sarah?
Yeah, I'm echoing what Sarah and Ruth have both said and offered so much detail. I think I'll just shift the perspective slightly, because one of the things that I think the last couple of years in our kind of understanding of alternative assessment and delivering that has really surfaced for us is that inclusivity or exclusivity. So we've had so many benefits of shifting online and being able to pivot, not least the agility of our academic colleagues to rethink their assessments and redesign them. Our students exposed and experiencing different forms of assessment and working and practicing in different ways. But also what that means for our students who have support plans in place. And for some, it's been a very heartening and positive experience of being able to be at home and be able to work online, which for Newcastle University has not been a traditional way of working. But for other students, it's been incredibly isolating and really changed their thinking. And for some of our students, we all probably acknowledge this, that actually they haven't had access to the equipment and the technical kind of tools that they have needed. And that's whether that be from their where they live in terms of geographically where they live, or in terms of the equipment, computers, for example. And that's really, you know, shone a light on some of those real differences and diversity in our student body, and something that we need to be really mindful of moving forward, that this gives us the opportunity to actually develop and deliver more innovative, inclusive assessment practices for learning and as learning, but we can't leave anyone behind. And I think that's an important message for us, certainly as deans, but I think as a university as well.
Absolutely.
Just pick up on something Ruth said there around the support that we've received from, you know, colleagues in the TEL community, which has been, you know, really outstanding, but also colleagues within disciplines and across disciplines. I think where we have had areas of expertise within the faculty, you know, colleagues who have done different types of assessment or are trying something new, you know, they've been really keen to share their practices with colleagues. And so we have created these practices of community that have allowed us to, you know, think about our approaches and help each other out in terms of, you know, flexible delivery, but also flexible assessments. And that's been really rewarding to see that colleagues who wouldn't necessarily, you know, come in contact with each other and talk about assessment have been doing so. So I think that's been a real bonus of the change in our assessment practice.
Right. We know that staff invest a lot of time in the feedback they provide to students, but students don't always feel satisfied with their feedback. Why is there this disconnect, and what can we do to improve this?
I'm not talking from a HASS perspective just for this question, but actually from a university-wide perspective, because I had the privilege of leading a small sprint, which is a bit of an investigation into a topic or an issue that we feel is important or pertinent to us at the moment. So feedback practice was the topic that we felt was worth this investigation. And so a small team spent a couple of weeks talking to students and garnering feedback from students about their feedback. And what we learned from that was quite a number of things, and we've also designed something too, which I'll come back to. One of the things that we learned is that feedback is one of the most important pieces of information that our students get from university experience. And their feedback that they receive here through their eyes and their words is different to the way that they have been experiencing feedback before they got to university. And for them, that's a challenge. And it's not unknown to us, but how we bridge that knowledge, that developmental gap in developing the use of feedback in university is a real challenge to us. Students really, really want their feedback to be timely. Now, that's really interesting because that doesn't necessarily mean in relation to our 20-day turnaround policy. In fact, very few of our students talked about that when they were talking about feedback. But what they talked about very much was having time to absorb the feedback that they received and learn and gain from it so that it could influence or inform their next assessment piece. So for each student, that's going to be quite a different thing, that timeliness. And the only other point I'll make at this moment is the personalization and the interpersonal relationship that feedback has for our students. And we often see it as something that we do and something that we give to students at the end of an assessment. And most students see feedback at the end of an assessment given to them. But what our students really value from the now sprint findings is what they can do with that feedback, how they can talk about it, how they can process it so that it's as valuable as it can be to inform their learning. So as a result of that, we developed a bit of a, it's not a module, it's something that you can drop into Canvas, a bit of a set of tools that our students can use to make the most of the feedback that they receive. And there's a little bit of advice for our colleagues who are developing their feedback practices, but mainly it's for students to make the most of their feedback. So I'm hoping that will become more visible as this next year moves forward. It was designed by everyone in the university, not a particular faculty or discipline. So I'm hoping it's fairly generic and really accessible and user-friendly.
Can I just check how people are accessing that, Sarah? Is it available in Canvas Commons and they can just download it into their Canvas course?
It is indeed. It's still got a little bit of work to do yet, Graeme, and some of the members of your team in LTDS are still working on that. But yes, it's a Commons piece that can just be embedded into a module in Canvas.
Great. Ruth?
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't think there's much more to add than what Sarah's just said, because I think the key to getting feedback right is speaking with the students and finding out what the students want or what their expectation is. And I know as part of the sprint, that's very much what Sarah and her team have been doing. But yeah, within our own practice, within my practice, what we found is when we speak to students, their expectation of what feedback is going to be compared to what our expectation as academics on what we think good feedback is quite different. And it's trying to bring those two closer together so that we're educating ourselves, understanding what it is that the students want, but we're also helping the students during induction and that transition to university on what they're going to get from us and how they can use that to develop their practice as they move through university. And hopefully some of this information that's coming in the Canvas Commons will help with that, because I think that's the problem that we've got. It's what students think is feedback, or the feedback that they've had from their previous educational experience, and what we think is feedback and what we're going to give the students. And it's just bringing the two together. So I think really the key to all of this is talking and listening to our students.
Do we think we need to help students with strategies on what to do with their feedback and how to use it?
Yeah. I definitely think we do. I mean, one of the things we've kind of investigated in FMS as a kind of initial thing is that they need to pick up their feedback. So it used to be in the day where you used to have the pile of essays sat in the office. Now, obviously, because they get their electronic copy back, we can actually monitor that as well through whether they've picked it up or not. And it is interesting. There is a cohort of students that don't pick their feedback up. So first of all, it's educating that, you know, there is some feedback, please pick it up, and then speaking with your tutor and actually working through that feedback. That's going to help them. So yeah, definitely as much as we can to kind of educate them on how they can use their feedback to feed forward, really, to ensure that it does help with their next piece of assessment that they get in.
I think sometimes we can be a lot more explicit with that, because I think as a teaching team, we often understand that, you know, a piece of assessment in one module or in one unit or in one area will go forward maybe to a different module or even a different stage of their degree. But I'm not sure we always make that explicit enough to students. And I think, you know, an overall arching map of assessment and how it all fits together not only helps students make that clearer, but I think it helps us as teaching teams to make those links between assessments when, you know, it may be linking to an assessment on a module that we don't personally contribute to or deliver to. But we can direct students to, when we're setting our assessments, to say, you know, when you get your feedback from this piece of assessment, you know, please bear it in mind, because it'll be really useful for you when you go into stage two or when you go into this module. And I think that allows the students to see that we have a more cohesive plan, and we know that we have designed our programs in that way. I think one of the things that we've been doing quite well in SAGE is involving students in exemplars and actually timetabling them in sessions within our modules, where students, you know, they've had the assessment brief, they've had the chance to look at the assessment criteria, and then they come into a session, they use the criteria to mark or to rank exemplars from previous submissions or similar. And students find that really valuable, because not only does it give them a chance to actually see what's expected in relation to the criteria, especially as well if it's quite a novel piece of assessment, quite an innovative piece of assessment, it allows them a chance just to see what that assessment looks like. Because I think sometimes students are quite anxious about an innovative assessment because they're not quite sure what we're looking for. And by giving them the chance to mark those exemplars and, you know, do it in groups and talk to each other, then I think it reassures them that they know what the submission should look like, but also that they know what they need to do to go up the grade boundaries for each of the different assessment criteria.
Right. In what ways can students be involved in assessment design and processes moving forward, authentic assessment and engagement?
Can I just kick that off? I think Sarah's made a really good point around thinking through engaging our students in learning and understanding assessment criteria, how it's processed and used by program teams. So having examples to match feedback and marks to, and having a go at assessing or evaluating pieces of work from the module or from modules that they've studied, I think is a really helpful thing to do. But a lot of my practice in combined honours has gone quite a way further than that, in terms of and enabling students to design their own assessments and to prioritize their own criteria depending on what it is that they're actually producing, and to enable students to influence and actually to manipulate the format of assessments as well. So choosing which format it's best to submit their chosen piece of work. Now, it's very specific because these modules are intended to bring together subjects. Students in combined, as you know, study two or three subjects, and the idea behind these types of assessment are to view the students as the experts in their own learning across their subjects and pull those subjects together in relation to an interesting topic that actually is underpinned by all of the disciplines. And then how they produce that and speak to it can be very personal. And I think that authentic nature of that assessment deals with a lot of the sector worrying, plagiarism, essay mill, all of the things that are filtering around Wonky and all of the platforms currently around our innovations and assessment, but actually put the onus back on the students themselves to think through what assessment means for them. So I think anything that develops their own practice and their own understanding is helpful as assessment for and as learning for the future, for them in work and in further study.
And I think within the Faculty of Medical Sciences, where we've got programmes that are much more regulated and we may be quite stringent in the types of assessments or the types of questions we might be asking, one of the things that we've been trying to do with it within FMS with some of our programmes is actually we've brought students in to work on working groups where they've looked at our marking criteria, they've looked at our rubrics and given us feedback on what those mean to them as the students. So we're not changing the overall question, but actually, does the marking criteria make sense to the student? It makes sense to us. And actually, when we sat down with the students, some of the things they weren't quite getting it, and we got them to help us rewrite the marking criteria so it was more student friendly and more understandable. So again, there are ways that you can actually get the students involved, even if you're very strict on we must be assessing this area in this way. The students can still interact, and it was quite surprising, and looking at some things where I thought this is quite an obvious marking criteria, an obvious rubric, and the students misinterpreted it, and it was really obvious, and once they said it I could see it. So working with the students in that way has helped us within FMS.
Yeah, and we did the same in SAGE. So I think those sessions where they're timetable and they can come along and use those exemplars, that gives us as markers real insight into how students are understanding the criteria. And I think it allows us to have that dialogue with students. And, you know, if they're unclear as to what is the difference between a 2-2 and a 2-1 or a 2-1 and a first, then that allows us to reflect on them and revise them with their input. I know in SAGE, some colleagues as well have worked with colleagues in LTDS to write those criteria and think about the language that's used. So it is, you know, a lot more focused on the student rather than sort of more difficult to decipher academic language. And I think that's been a real benefit. But I think, you know, all colleagues are keen to listen to the students and reflect on the practices and revise as necessary. And we do so as well in response to colleagues, especially, you know, we have multiple markers assessing the same piece of assessment. And sometimes, you know, as a person writing those assessment criteria, you think they're really clear, but then a colleague will come along and say, well, I don't understand, you know, I found it really difficult to mark against that criteria. And, you know, what does it mean? And again, that allows us to reflect and revise as necessary.
There's lots of work about improving the student assessment literacy, but then it's really interesting to hear that sort of wider learning that we're doing as well about the students' perceptions, etc. That's really interesting. Great. Okay, can I just take the time just to thank all three of you for contributing to this discussion? It's been really, really interesting. And hopefully the listeners of the podcast will find this also.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you to Graeme for leading that conversation and to Sarah, Ruth and Sarah for their great input and great insight into assessment here at Newcastle University. I hope you enjoyed today's episode, and if you want to learn any more, please visit our show notes and remember to like, subscribe and tell your friends all about this podcast. See you in 2 weeks' time. Bye.